The following feature presentation is part of the SKYwalking Network.
Hey everybody, this is Kevin Toft from the SKYwalking Network, wishing you and your family happy holidays.
This is Jess Walls, and I just wanted to give a big hey to Richard, Sarah, and all of the SKYwalkers. I want to wish everyone the happiest of holidays this year. I know this year looks different for some of you. I know it looks different for me. I am definitely not able to see as much family as I would like, but I am so grateful to have some amazing friends who have invited me into their traditions this year. Whatever that looks like for you, I hope you all have a safe and happy holiday.
Hi, Richard and Sarah, and to all the SKYwalkers out there, happy holidays, Merry Christmas, and Joyeux Noël from the Gabays in Manitoba, Canada. Can't wait till we meet again for a fuzzy tauntaun. Till the spire.
Are you ready?
Welcome to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, well, this is a movie Disney should have made.
You're more than just fans. You're family.
Best day ever!
Secrets lab.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey.
When you use a bird to write with, it's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, Never Never Land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, Skywalkers! We want to wish you all the happiest of holidays. And we hope everyone is having a great and safe season, which includes Hanukkah, Christmas, and of course, Life Day. And now, we want to welcome you back to
Skywalking Through Neverland,
and our holiday special. I am Richard Woloski, and now everyone please say hello to my sweetie wife, and look how sweet she looks right now.
Oh, thank you. I feel very sweet. I love the red, black, and white look for Christmas. I think it's very chic. I don't know, which is why I got these fuzzy ears. They're fuzzy. I got those last year at Disneyland, and I figured I'd put together an ensemble that matched.
You're looking very classic.
Thank you.
I can imagine George Lucas having a flannel scarf like this.
Ooh, yes. And this pin is from Luminous Beings, Morgan Rooks. It's a Convor with rainbow wings. So, yay, it supports the Trevor Project, which is LGBTQ community. Oh, did you introduce me and then I didn't go on? I got sidetracked with how cute we looked?
Yeah, it's like, okay, this is your line.
All right, well.
Someone's had a little too much spiked eggnog today.
But you know what? So while we're done talking about ourselves, we figured we'd want to welcome all of you Skywalkers to Skywalking Through Neverland. We are your enthusiastic podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom, and Pixar fandom.
Yeah, all right, we're going to cut you off, okay?
Oh, no!
No more eggnog for Sarah.
No more eggnog and brandy? How about, is it time then for some pixie dust and some Wookiee hugs?
Always.
To give to our family of Skywalkers?
Mm-hmm.
Yay, mm-hmm. It's that time. If you're just listening for the first time, you are now a Skywalker like all the rest of us. So join us and the rest of the Skywalker family on a fun, positive adventure through fandom, which may or may not include some sidetracking.
And some spiked eggnog.
Yes.
Which we've seen in droves. Well, one of us has. Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on December the 23rd, 2020. So we want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas Eve.
Indeed. And we are being sponsored by Small World Vacations, which is a diamond level Disney vacation planner travel agency. And they can help you book your next trip to Disney parks around the world, the ones that are open. And best of all, their service is free of charge. So all you have to do is head to smallworldvacations.com and just get a no obligation price quote and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
All right, Holiday Mini. Gotta ask you what time it is, okay?
Oh, Merry Christmas, Richard! Oh! Now, I want to tell you that it is 1:10 p.m.
Well, thank you, Holiday Minnie. That's very, very nice and very informative. All right, so I gotta ask you all, how many of us have binged on the series, the toys that made us, the movies that made us, the holiday movies that made us, or the new docu-series, A Toy Store Near You?
I have!
Guess what, Minnie?
What?
Those series were all created by Brian Volk-Weiss, who is back on the show today to discuss the second season of A Toy Store Near You, which premieres on December the 25th.
I am so excited about this interview. It's so much fun. But now, before we get into that, let's roll into Things We Want to Share and our tribute to Jeremy Bulloch.
Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
On December 17th, we lost another veteran Star Wars actor. Last month, we lost David Prowse, and now we lost Jeremy Bulloch, who played Boba Fett in The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. And he wasn't just the man who gave character to Boba Fett. He also played Lieutenant Shackle, the Imperial officer who's holding back Princess Leia on Cloud City as she's yelling, "It's a trap."
Oh, cool.
Admiral Ackbar wasn't the first one to yell that. It's Leia. That officer, that's Jeremy Bulloch.
Oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. And he also made a cameo in Revenge of the Sith as Captain Colton, who was among the crew aboard the Sundered Heart when Bail Organa, Yoda, and Obi-Wan went on the search for a surviving Jedi. Mm. He's the pilot.
Okay.
It's ironic that we saw the Book of Boba Fett, the teaser trailer, at the end of the Mandalorian episode, the season 2 finale. It's ironic that we saw the beginning of this new series as Jeremy Bulloch is leaving us.
Very true.
But you know what? I really hope they at least name a character after him for this new series. Din Bulloch? Jeremy Jarin?
Something cool something, like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, they gotta do something in honor of Jeremy Bulloch.
Yeah.
I just hope that Jeremy Bulloch had the chance to see the Boba Fett episodes of The Mandalorian.
Yay.
I would love to know what he thought of those.
That would be a cool conversation.
Now we can all live on the memory of Jeremy Bulloch through the Book of Boba Fett.
Yes. Yeah, now we met Jeremy Bulloch at Star Wars Weekends in 2014, and we had like our first press passes, and we got a chance to interview him backstage at Disney for 10 minutes. And he was our first big Star Wars cast interview.
Yeah, I gotta tell you, I was very anxious and nervous about this one because it was our first big Star Wars interview. But this is someone I've known since 1980.
Yeah.
I've read about him. I've known about Jeremy Bulloch. And now we're going to talk with him. Like, I got 35 years of questions for you. We have 10 minutes.
Well, I think you were more nervous about meeting him, and I was more nervous about the technology working. Like, I think it was our new Zoom recorder, right? Mm-hmm. Didn't we, like, get it for this trip? And, like, I was hoping everything would work okay, and
audio better stick to the card.
Yeah. But, yeah, he was just the sweetest, sweetest guy. And you know what? Let's go ahead and replay that interview from that day.
Maybe I can help you. I am Boba Fett. Follow me, friend.
We are here at Star Wars Weekends 2014, and we are talking to Mr. Boba Fett himself, Mr. Jeremy Bulloch.
Look at the applause. Oh, hear the applause.
Car goes wild.
Yes, you can put that in, can't you? Yes, of course.
You were just saying before we started interviewing that you have been here several times before at Star Wars Weekends. What has been your favorite fan moment?
I think what's so lovely is not the age of different people, the young kids who like Boba Fett, but you see the grown-up ladies, gentlemen saying, "Hey, Boba, wow," because they see a T-shirt or a hat and must gather that is Boba Fett. So if any of you want to copy Boba Fett walking through the crowds, you could probably get away with it.
Yeah, you must be amazed at all the shirts and paraphernalia Boba Fett has.
Well, I'm going to go and look at some stuff later on this afternoon, but some of the stuff they make is brilliant. I mean, there's a shirt this weekend, which is slightly, not just an ordinary T-shirt, it's slightly soft and pudgy, but it looks so realistic, so I'll be watching, I'll be looking, and probably buying.
Oh, yeah. We went into Darth Maul thinking we'll buy
Darth Maul. Yeah.
We'll buy one or two things, $200 later. That's trip number one.
Oh. Yeah. Would you mind buying my one?
Yeah, give us your wish list, and we'll see what we can do for you.
The wish list. The wedge list, yes.
I have a question for you, actually. Now, if Boba Fett were here at Disney World, what would be his favorite ride other than Star Tours?
That's well done, because I was about to say Star Tours, because he would be looking for himself every time he's on, because it's at random, and you don't know whether you'll be seen, each one.
Right.
Favorite ride? I must say, it's not a ride, but the Indiana Jones Spectacular, I think, is fantastic. It's a bit scary, that, but they're so well-trained. And it's just a very good 20 minutes.
Absolutely.
And people can say, why, it's hot, let's go in and see this. It's really very good.
Now, when you see Indiana Jones, does your mind go to, someday I want to carbon freeze that man?
Well, I've done it once. when he was, Han Solo. But now, now he's not Han Solo. I get so many mixed. Indiana Jones, he's difficult to get into carbonite. That's not my territory, and I have to stick to Han Solo. He's the one I want.
Right. In The Empire Strikes Back, when Boba Fett and Darth Vader has just captured Han and the gang in the dining hall, and the doors close, what do you think happens from there?
Mayhem. Just total mayhem.
Does anyone go down in this mayhem?
I'm not allowed to tell you that.
Oh! Okay.
What happens behind closed doors stays behind closed doors.
I'll tell you what I will say.
Okay.
There's something about Boba Fett. I think that Han Solo and Boba Fett fought together some years before.
Right.
And they have a pact. You stick to what you're doing, I'll do what I'm doing. Now keep out of my face. And then things happen since then, and so it's back on. So when he says in the Sarlacc pit near there, he said, Boba Fett, where? Now that must mean something.
Oh.
So I think it's probably... That's to do with it. He's got to get himself back on track, because Boba Fett's not at his best, because in that Sarlacc pit, the jetpack's not working quite right, so he can't get out. So Han Solo's the one he wants.
Right. Now, if Boba Fett were to have a standalone film, which he's going to have eventually, and he gets out of the Sarlacc pit, who would you say would you want to rescue him, and where does he go from there?
He'd probably, Princess Leia, he'd say, come with me or you're gone. That's it, you're gone, come with me. And she would say, who are you? I'm Boba Fett. So that's all I can help her with.
Now, in the expanded universe, Boba Fett teaches Han and Leia's kids to be warriors, which I think I would love to see something like that.
There's so much, is lovely, there's so much going on. With the new films, I'm looking forward to seeing the new films, 2015, I think it is. There's so much to do. I mean, now, here we are, there's Star Wars, Star Tours, it's remained 30-odd years, and they're still selling merchandise, but some beautiful stuff. I mean, I have Donald Duck as Boba Fett, and it's got the full suit on. Beautiful sculpture, which last time I was here, I bought that. There's something about it, and you see grown-ups, kids going, hi, Boba, how are you? Well, at the meantime, I put my thumb up and say, hi, yeah, nice, Boba. But it's not me, it's the great thing about the character. It's not me as an actor, it's the character, I think, that you only have to look at the costume. He's cool.
Yeah, and you have your own costume that was fan-made and presented to you.
Yeah, the dented helmet. They presented me, this is a few years ago, but and I'm not soft, but nearly the tears come to your eyes and say, look, guys. And I made them a sort of a glass plaque to say the Fett Project and then the date. All the people, there were 31 different people involved, making the helmet, the knee pads, someone did the coloring, someone did the etching, some incredible performance.
Yeah, there's tears coming to my eyes. Yeah,
well, you'll have to queue up, get your outfit. And I've worn it twice, and I'm wearing it in the summer at a special charity event. People know that there's loads of stormtroopers going to be at this event. And, oh, look, there's a Boba Fett, there's several of those, but I shall be walking through.
When is this and where is it?
This will be sometime, I think, in July. I can't be sure, but you mustn't give the game away.
Okay, so this is not something that's going to be publicized.
It's fun if they don't know.
Oh, I see.
Wow. And where is it going to be exactly?
It's going to be in probably Earl's Court, London.
Oh.
The big place there. They have that show. And they've said, would I do it? And I said, well, yes.
It'd be
fun.
Wow. Will you reveal later on that it was you?
Oh, yes. No, I think because there are several. There'll be about four or five different Boba Fetts walking around and saying, hi, how are you? And then I usually take a bucket with me to get people to put money in. And I remember one said, put some money in the bucket. And he said, what? He said, put some money in the bucket. And he said, well, why is he behaving like this?
Yeah.
I said, sorry, pretend, just a funny joke, sorry. Because some people took it for real. Put some money in the bucket. And then I sit down and just have a cup of tea and see if anybody knows what's going on. But, you know, you have some fun with it, plus you're raising money for Make-A-Wish.
Oh, yeah.
Most important as well. And I think it's... this is fun. You know, people say, why do you go all the way over to Orlando? Well, I thought that's the last place. I mean, you get all this. And I said, well, because we're doing a lot of good. There's a lot of charity stuff going on. And I think that's more important. You see all the kids and they giggle and laugh and... it's fantastic.
Yeah. Just...
right.
We have a listener question, actually, from Twitter, from Darth Texas. And
Darth Texas?
Yeah.
Welcome.
His name. I know.
He's a Sith accountant.
Now, if he asks, if Slave One were a car, what would it be?
Oh, that's a good one. Slave One would be a car. Probably a Ferrari.
Ooh.
I think a Ferrari, just edges the Rolls Royce. They're more dense in a Rolls Royce than there is a Ferrari.
Absolutely.
Because it just goes forward and it's bumping into people. But it's cool. There is Slave 2 as well. Do you know that?
You probably did.
Yeah, after he gets out of the Sarlacc pit, he buys like an old police car type of ship.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. I've never seen a picture of this.
No, I think that's quite clever. They leave it in case they use it in a piece of the filming. You just don't know.
Yeah.
But I think it's great to leave people sort of slightly on edge, going, so what do we do? Oh, gosh. You know, don't tell everybody everything. Just leave back something to say, yes, it might. If they say, does this happen? It might. I don't know. Might.
I see why they call you the best bounty hunter in the galaxy.
This is Jeremy Bullock, Boba Fett from Star Wars. And I'm skywalking through Neverland. Follow me.
All right, well, several Star Wars cast members reached out through social media to voice their condolences. So as we read these, anyone who's watching, if you want to share any kind of Jeremy Bullock story, feel free, or any memories or thoughts you have on him or his characters.
I'm sure many of us have met him because he's been to so many conventions, celebrations, or Comic-Con, and he was so approachable.
Yeah.
I've met him just walking around the floor sometimes.
Aww.
Yeah, he's just such a sweet man. This is just such a sad occurrence that we lost him. Darth Tuba in the chat says, one of the first Star Wars celebrities I ever met. He was always so friendly. Yeah, very much so. All right, Daniel Logan reached out on his social media account and said, I am sad to hear of the passing of Jeremy Bullock, a Star Wars family member. I will never forget all that you taught me and all the good times we had together. You will be forever remembered. Cons won't be the same without you. The Force will be with you always. Rest in peace, my Mando brother.
I love that. Mark Hamill also
mentioned, Jeremy Bulloch was the quintessential English gentleman, a fine actor, delightful company, and so kind to everyone lucky enough to meet or work with him. I will deeply miss him, and I'm so grateful to have known him.
I really wanted that scene in the Mandalorian. I wanted Boba Fett to be on that ship when Luke Skywalker comes in.
Oh, yeah.
just to get those two together again.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Billy Dee Williams reached out and said, "Today we lost the best bounty hunter in the galaxy. Rest in peace, Jeremy Bulloch." Jonas Suotimo, who plays Chewbacca in the new Star Wars films and Solo, he says, "I'm very sad to learn that Jeremy Bulloch has passed. He was such a friendly presence at many Star Wars events I attended, sending condolences to his loved ones."
That's so lovely.
Scott Bowman.
Yeah, says, Scott Bowman.
I knew that Bulloch was Lieutenant Shekel. Didn't know he was in Revenge of the Sith. We just talked about him on today's episode 42 of What a Piece of Junk, a Star Wars podcast. Rest in peace to the original generation Mandalorian.
Yeah. The OG.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
George Lucas, he says, Jeremy brought the perfect combination of mystery and menace to his performance of Boba Fett, which is just what I wanted the character to convey. In addition, Jeremy was a true gentleman who was very supportive of Star Wars and its fans, and I'm very grateful for his contributions to the saga and its legacy. Well, thank you, Jeremy Bulloch, from us, for being such a great guy whenever we had all met, and for being such a great and approachable representative for Star Wars and to its fans.
And, you know, we're thinking of your family as well.
All right. That was a tearjerker.
Yeah. Well, coming up in just a few minutes, we will be talking with Brian Volk-Weiss about his new series, A Toy Store Near You. And this is about independent toy stores from all over the world. And it's about their toys and also how they're dealing with the COVID closures this year.
I love this concept because it showed us these little toy stores and collector shops. Okay, in the chat, who frequented one of these shops when you were a kid? This is a toy store that was run by a mom and pop rather than a big Toys R Us store. So, in honor of Christmas and the theme of toys, Sarah, let's share the toy stores we went to as kids.
Okay, so who wants to go first?
You go first, okay?
Are you sure?
Yeah, you go first.
Okay. So I had in my memory, a fuzzy memory of going to this little toy store where there was lots of Playmobil. So I went to the authorities on this, on my toy store life, and I went to my mom and dad and said, "Hey, mom, hey, dad, do you remember what this toy store was called?" And my dad, who keeps a ledger all the way back, looked it up. And he had the exact name and address of this toy store. So are you ready?
And he also had all the receipts too.
Yes, he did. That's the funny thing. So this was Treehouse Toys at Galleria Oaks Shopping Center in Austin, Texas, off of 183 and Anderson Mill Road. So as a kid, I wouldn't have remembered those details. But there you go. But once he said Treehouse Toys, I was like, okay, I remember that. And I think their logo had like a little tree and a little kid. Anyway,
that's an awesome name for a toy store.
Isn't it fun? Mm-hmm. I believe they had like that theme inside, like a big tree in the corner with like the branches on the top of the store.
Oh, you would have
store.
To.
Yeah. I mean, if you have it. So then I remember going there and always like just being so enamored with the Playmobil. And they had Playmobil is like so cool. It's like, they're like little people and little animals, and it's very, very detailed. Like all the different like things, the molded plastic is like very detailed. And so basically every time I got a good report card, which was all the time, according to my mom, and that's very true. I was a little Hermione. She would take me to this toy store and I could buy one sensible sized toy. Because there were the Playmobil sets that were like the gigantic like,
castles,
pirate ship and castles and things. But I could get the little sets like a bedroom furniture set or a bathroom furniture set. Basically, my entire dollhouse, which was four stories, was entirely Playmobil furniture. And the Playmobil people. And I even had a Playmobil zoo, which I loved. And now this is kind of where it veers off of the toy store, but goes into the Playmobil. But I remember that Playmobil actually had a suggestion address that you could write to. And so I was always wanting like a forest animal set, like something with deer and foxes and little bunny rabbits. Mm-hmm. And I wrote in. And several years later, I was like back at that toy store and I saw a Playmobil set that had this trees and forest and deer and stuff. And I was like, oh my gosh, I think they actually like...
It's the Sarah Play set.
Yes. But so I was excited about that. So I, on a whim, I went to Google Maps yesterday to look and see if this Treehouse Toys was still there. It's not still there. Do you know what it is?
A Starbucks?
It's
a Baby Gap?
No, it's North Austin Bingo.
What does that mean?
Bingo place. I was like, what? I didn't understand. But yeah, so I have fond memories of Treehouse Toys and mom having to always buy me things because I got good grades.
Oh, that I'm loving this name. That's better than my toy store.
Oh, no.
But before we go on to my toy store, let's hit up some of these comments over here. Megan Rickard says, I was a Toys R Us kid. Oh, we were all Toys R Us kids.
Yes, I definitely was too.
Outside of that, I don't remember much.
Okay.
Yeah, these little mom and pop toy stores, they weren't as prevalent as they are now. Mm-hmm. Where now they're not toy stores, they're more collector stores.
Right.
Darth Tuba says, three stores come to mind when I was a kid.
Wow, three of them.
Yeah. A tiny store in St. Croix that I visited while I'm on vacation in the 80s.
Oh.
And remember picking up the 12-inch C-3PO figure.
12-inch, wow.
All right. He also recalls Toy Kingdom.
Ooh.
In Flemington, New Jersey.
That's a good name, too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And Sellright Toys in Paramus, New Jersey.
Okay. Courtney Turkell looks like she's also a Toys R Us fan. And KB Toys. Oh, that's right. KB Toys. Remember that?
Yeah, they were Toys R Us.
Right.
And below that, there were like Child World. Mm. And on the same level as Child World, there were KB Toys.
Okay.
And Child World, I'm not sure if this was a chain, but this was the store right next to Toys R Us in Framingham, Massachusetts.
Okay.
So we go to Toys R Us, that was the new store, and then we go to the a little bit more rundown Child World. Now, I recall this Child World, they had a sign one Christmas where you could hire a Darth Vader to come to your home and help you clean up.
Okay. Wait. That's right.
Yeah. You've heard me tell a story before.
Yeah.
And so whenever I think of Child's World, I always think of that. You can have Darth Vader put on a little apron, I guess. I don't know. And he'll help clean up. Mm-hmm. All right. Now I spoke a little bit about my toy store, the one I went to as a kid during our discussion with Brian. But this store was Mr. Big Toyland. And this was located, if you want to go by, at 399 Moody Street in Waltham, Massachusetts.
Now, do you remember this address from being a kid, or did you have to look that up?
No, I looked it up.
Okay.
Now, his sign proudly said, discount prices, which was false advertising since he was so much more expensive than any other toy store. Not sure why he got away with that.
Mm.
Now, this musty and dusty toy store had shelves that were just stocked to the ceiling with vintage toys. And this is before vintage toys were a thing.
Mm-hmm.
He would have things from like the 50s and 60s.
Wow.
But of course, I didn't want that. I was looking for the Star Wars section.
Right. And a lot of the 50s and 60s toys, I remember we talked with Steve Sansweet, and he started collecting those before Star Wars toys.
Yeah.
So they were collector's items.
Oh, they were. But back then, they weren't collector's items. They were just old toys.
That's true.
Now, I don't know how, but this guy, his name is Arthur. I guess he's Mr. Big. I don't know. But he got all the new Star Wars figures before any other store, before Toys R Us, before Child's World, and he would make you put your name on a reservation sheet, and then he would make you wait weeks before you could get that figure, even though he had a big display rack behind his counter full of the action figures.
Hmm.
So this was definitely a power move.
Yeah.
And he knew it too, and it was very smart, because you would come in, and you couldn't get a Star Wars figure, so little kids are like, Mom, I want something else. There's Star Trek right over there. Yeah, and
That was sneaky.
It was, because he once convinced me that these Micronaut toys are part of the Star Wars line. I didn't know this. This guy had Star Wars toys before anyone else, so apparently this guy knew something. And he was a rock star among the kids.
Right, right.
Because this guy, he had his hand full of Star Wars toys. So yeah, he was a rock star. But I just thought he knew something that I didn't. So mm-hmm. if you say these are part of the Star Wars line, I will believe you. Now, it's funny because my secret squirrel stories go back to Mr. Big Toyland.
Oh my gosh.
Because when you're kids, you'd go into the toy store and his wife and his mother, they'd all be like peeking around corners, just watching the kids. And it's like, you know, we can see you, right? But they tried so hard to be so secretive. So a bunch of us would go in and just start messing with them. You know, you go this way, I'll go that way. You take the west wing, I'll take the east wing, and just start moving around. And there was only three of them and like six of us.
That's so weird.
Yeah, so no wonder he hated us.
Mm.
But alas, this store, like yours, went out of business sometime in the very late 80s. And now it's a furniture store.
Oh, how sad.
When we went back to Newton a couple of years ago, we went by the store.
Right.
And we just ran into this furniture store for like a couple of seconds just so, you know, to revisit the past.
Yeah.
No, Kylo, I'm not going to let the past die. So all that's left now are my memories and this commercial I found on YouTube.
Are you tired of walking through enormous toy stores with invisible sales help and then being given a rain check? Then go to Mr. Big Toyland, 399 Moody Street, Waltham. They've got it all. Huge selections of Fisher-Price toys for the little ones, every game imaginable for kids of all ages. And for the collector, an incredible selection of new, hard-to-find and antique dolls, even rare G.I. Joes. F&B, Ginny, Madame Alexander, just to name a few. So go see Mr. and Mrs. Big at Mr. Big Toyland, 893-8582.
All right, well, now let's play a few more Skywalker holiday special messages, and then we have to roll into a tradition that, Richard, you've held since our first year of doing Skywalking Through Neverland.
Mm-hmm.
And what is that?
Well, that tradition is playing the Spanish holiday classic Ryu Chi by the Monkees.
Hey, hey, holiday Skywalkers. It's Bryn McKinnon from the Window to the Magic podcast, and I am digging into the holiday season with all things cozy. I've got cozy drinks. We're talking about hot cocoa, hot cider, hot toddies, you name it. If it's cozy and you can drink it, I'm all over it. Eggnog. That's not hot, but it's super cozy and delicious. I'm doing cookies. Christmas cookies. Holiday cookies. All the cookies. I've got gingerbread. Not the cookies, but the gingerbread. You know, the kind that goes in a pan, like a baking pan. I made homemade fruit cake. Fruit cake? Yeah, fruit cake. It's actually delicious when you make it yourself and you don't use all the green cherries. I mean, but if you like the green cherries, hey, go for it. I've also got coziness in the living room with the crackling Yule log video on the television. We don't have a working fireplace. That's okay. We've got the Yule log on the TV. It's great. I light a candle. It smells like a fire. We got it on. It's crackling. It's beautiful. It's so cozy. Anyway, I'm wrapping myself in warmth. We've got Christmas blankets. We've got kids snuggled up in cozy pajamas. I've got cozy pajamas. Cozy, cozy, cozy is the word for the season for me this year. And because we also celebrate Hanukkah in addition to Christmas in our house, I just wanted to thank Skywalking Through Neverland, Sarah and Richard, and all of the contributors for being a light in the darkness for us this year and always. So here's to a 2021 with lots of potential for light and wonderfulness. We can all pull together and make that happen. Sending lots of love to all of you from Los Angeles. Happy holidays.
Hi guys, this is Details, wishing you all a very merry, happy and safe holiday season. Sending lots of love to Richard and Sarah and to all those skywalking through Neverland. May the Force be with you.
Riu riu shiu la guadaribera, Dios guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera. Dios guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera. Riu riu shiu la guadaribera. Dios guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera. Dios guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera.
El lobo rabioso la quiso morder, mas Dios poderoso la supo defender. Quiso le hacer que no pudiese pecar, ya no original es tu virgen no tuviera.
Riu, riu, shiu, la guadaribera. Dios guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera. Dios guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera.
Esta que es nacido es el gran monarca, Cristo patriarca de carne vestido, ya nos redimido con se arce chiquito, aunque infinito, finito se hiciera.
Riu, riu, shiu, la guadaribera.
Dios
guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera.
Dios
guardó el lobo de nuestra cordera.
What you see in the store is a reflection of the personality of that store owner.
The ET finger light.
Iron Maiden reaction.
The USS flag.
Palatoy Death Star.
These are the only six known living examples of the last Starfighter toys. Welcome to the Batcave.
We never sat down with a plan to start a store.
Really?
A pebble fell, yeah. Hit a rock, hit another rock, and all of a sudden there's a rock slide avalanche.
One day I just said to Nick, wouldn't it be cool if we had a store that was half toys and half records?
We're not considered essential, but, you know, mental health is essential.
We're not able to do anything while this is going on. Technically speaking, we're not even supposed to be in the store right now while we're filming this.
We had to switch over to an online shipping business.
It's time to go into bank robber mode.
The panel burst into flame. The wall was on fire. The store is everything we have besides each other. And we didn't lose each other.
We're just ready to COVID, to get out of here, let the store be open, and just... let's live and love toys.
Since the pandemic has hit, chances are you've been watching more TV and streamed entertainment than ever before. And chances are you've seen the holiday movies that made us, the Mad About You reboot, or a toy store near you, or maybe you even rewatched the toys that made us, all of which were directed, produced, or created by Brian Volk-Weiss.
So we are so excited to have Brian Volk-Weiss back on Skywalking Through Neverland.
Hey, hey, hey Brian!
Thank you for having me back. I never take it for granted. By the way, I have to compliment you on your shirt. I have become obsessed with the Ewoks cartoon. Oh. Like, obsessed. So I just got the battle wagon. I'm late to it, but I have fallen in love.
Oh, yeah, I can't wait for it to come on Disney Plus so I can watch through it and remember from my, like, fuzzy four-year-old memory.
Yeah, Sarah was going through her drawer, like, what should I wear? It's like, oh, wear the Ewoks animated TV show shirt. That would be perfect for this.
And not to make you feel bad, I'm also a fan of the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, I can wear my Millennium Falcon Kenner shirt from her universe. Plug. All right, now let's now talk about you, because it doesn't look like this pandemic has slowed you down. You seem busier than ever.
It didn't slow us down, but we definitely had to do like about 3,000 pivots.
Wow.
You know, we just had a Movies That Made Us, two more episodes come up about a week ago on Netflix, and that was shot entirely with remote camera packages that we built in March and April, and we're, so, I mean, not not one shot in those episodes was done in a traditional way. And in a toy store near you, that is shot. People always say to me, how did you shoot during the pandemic? And I'm always like, we didn't. That show was shot entirely by the store owners and the employees. And then they sent us the footage and we edited it and did the legal work and the color and sound and music and that stuff. But I mean, it was shot entirely by the stores.
Okay. We were wondering about that, but that does make sense. We had a sneaking suspicion.
Yeah. Now, normally we don't like to binge shows because we want to absorb each episode, but we had to binge the first season of A Toy Store Near You, which can be found on YouTube, Amazon Prime, and Vimeo. This is such a fascinating series about toy stores and how they're dealing with COVID. How did this series first develop?
So people after Toys That Made Us, people were telling us for a long time, you know, hey, you should do a show about the stores. You should do a show about the stores. And I never wanted to because I have found, you know, as a producer and director, there are certain things in life that are great when you're there and not so great on television. And I didn't know how to do a show about toy stores that would be interesting for more than 5,000 people. So that's not enough people to green light a show. But when COVID started and, you know, California and L.A. was put in a lockdown, I was at Black Cat Comics in Burbank talking to the owner, one of the owners, Kyle. And I said to him, I'm like, well, you know, on Friday, the quarantine is starting. How does that affect you? And he was like, well, I've never been through a quarantine before, but if I had to guess, it means our income will drop to almost zero, but none of our expenses will go down. And when I heard that, you know, my first thought was, what can we do to help? And, you know, we're a production company with a distribution arm. You know, I think if we made toasters, we would have found a way to have toasters help, but, you know, as a production distribution company, we make television. So the idea was, why don't we make a show where the majority of the profit goes back to the stores? And also the exposure that the stores will get from the show will hopefully help them with their online sales. And that, you know, I greenlit the show the next day. And, you know, I called Billy Galaxy, who's the first show and the first store we did. And I said to Billy, I was like, hey, dude, if we did X, Y, and Z, could you shoot, you know, and we gave you a list of what to shoot, would you do it? And as soon as he said, yeah, he would do it, I knew we could do a series. And we sent an email out to, you know, stores that we knew. I think we sent an email to 50 stores. I think 31 said yes. And then we put a press release out and we got another 19 stores. So we're doing 50 stores total, five at a time.
Wow.
Wow. There ought to be a series on the making of A Toy Store Near You. This is fantastic how you're helping back this community. I didn't know about that.
Yeah. I mean, it's the least we could do.
Well, I know, like, you know, we watched a couple of these and we checked out some of those stores' live streams because we're like, oh, this is fun, you know, and they make a big production out of it. Like, it's super cool.
Yeah.
No, it's, well, I'll tell you something really interesting that I have not seen anybody write about this, and I'm not sure why, but, you know, in March, April, May, let's include June, all the toy stores that I know were very worried about going out of business and were having a horrible time. Starting somewhere in late August, going until September, up until this very minute, almost every store I'm aware of has said they're having the best year in the history of their stores.
Whoa.
Yeah. Whoa. And the theory, nobody knows for sure, but the theory is, obviously, there's understandably a lot of press about people losing their jobs and taking pay cuts and getting furloughed. And there's very little press about people who are not getting let go or furloughed or pay cuts. And I don't know the numbers, but if I had to guess, I think at least 75% of the country has not had to, you know, take pay cuts or lose jobs. But those people in that 75% category, they're not going on vacations. They're not having expensive dinners, expensive bottles of wine, whatever. So I think a lot of people have found themselves in the late summer with a lot more money than they normally have at that time of year. And they're buying stuff. So it you'll see in season two, I think in season one, it was like 70% about the toys and 30% about COVID. And in season two, yeah, I think it's 90% about the toys and 10% or less about COVID.
Right, right. Yeah, I think we noticed that because we got a little preview of season two.
Yeah, when I saw season two, I thought, oh, how is he going to make this different than season one? Was that a thought going in to season two? How can I make this different?
Yeah, we got a lot of comments on social media about it. Basically, the gist of the comment was, and we got hundreds of these, but if I summed them up into one statement, the gist of it would be, I'm already really depressed about COVID. Like, this is a really dark, crappy year. I was excited to see there was a new show on about toys, and then I watched it, and it was more depressing crap about COVID. So I don't do anything I'm not excited about, but I'm not one of these directors who's like, I'm making it for myself. Like if other directors want to do that, I respect it, but it's not for me. And it's like, if you get the same comment a couple hundred times, you know, that probably means a significant percentage of the audience felt that way. So we absolutely went into season two with the intention to drastically reduce the amount of COVID and 2020 stuff that we saw in season one.
That's why studios spend millions of dollars on this market research. You're all on what, free on social media. I can say the high point of season one was when that collector was saying how when he would open a toy, he would smell it. He liked the smell of that plastic. I'm like, oh, see, I'm not the only one who does that.
I do that. I always do that. Yeah, it's funny. You're absolutely right.
Oh, good.
Okay.
You see, Sarah, you see that?
All right. So I can no longer look at you funny?
Yeah. It's like, what are you doing? I'm smelling my toys. Okay. Give me a moment.
I like to smell books.
Then we all have something. Now, season two is coming out on Christmas Day. Can you give us an idea of what to expect of season two and how many episodes there's going to be and where can we find them?
So there's going to be 50 episodes total. We're releasing them five at a time. We will almost definitely do two seasons next year. I am hoping to do three. Like I said, I mean, we drastically diminished the 2020 factor. We absolutely are having a lot more deeper dives into the toys. We worked very closely with Mark Bellomo in season two. I think he's in season one once, but I believe he's in every episode of season two. So, you know, just to do a deeper dive into the story behind the toys. And also, like I said, there's just a lot more toys.
And who is Mark Bellomo, just for those of us?
So Mark Bellomo, you know how like when I was younger, maybe you guys too, like the source of information before Google was the Encyclopedia Britannica?
Yes.
Yeah, those hard copy things.
Mark Bellomo is the author of like the books about toys and pricing. So like whenever I'm in a toy store all over the world, like if I'm looking at a G.I. Joe thing and I'm like, hey, do you know if this is complete? If the owner doesn't know, they will 100% of the time go to a back room or a shelf and pull off a Bellomo book about that toy line, find the toy, and it'll give all the information about the toy. It'll have pictures of the toy and all the accessories, and it'll have a range of prices. Wow. And I think other people may have done books like this, but for whatever reason, no, like it's his Bellomo's books are the ones that are used by everybody for prices and for completeness.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Now, we were lucky enough to get a couple of links to season two in that Super 7 episode. Oh, my! Oh, I loved it. Just to give everyone a hint about season two, that Super 7 episode is fantastic. And every episode should come with a warning. Please put your credit cards in a safe place because you will want to go for them and want to use them.
It's so funny you say that. Like, I usually watch rough cuts very early in the morning. So I'll be sitting here at like 6:30 in the morning watching a rough cut. I'll hit pause and I'll start texting the owner. Hey, is that a ET finger light still available? Almost every US episode, I have bought something from that store.
That's so funny. Yeah.
At least one thing.
Yeah, put the cards in a Ziploc bag, put it in your freezer, and maybe put a bouncer in front of that.
Well, I don't know where you guys are, but have you heard of Frankensons?
Oh, yeah, we're in Long Beach.
Okay, great. So first of all, rule number one, I will only go once a year. Like, that is not somewhere I can go more than once.
Mm-hmm.
Rule number two, I take $1,000 cash and I leave my wallet in the car. Like, and that's it. Like, rule number three, there's this couple in the middle of the building. For those of you that don't know, it's literally two gigantic warehouses and they remove the wall that divides them. So it's like, and it's 600 vintage toy store sellers.
Yeah. It's like a Comic-Con every weekend.
I mean, it's like a permanent convention. That's what I always say. Yeah, exactly. And this couple in the middle of the building, I literally avoid them. I won't even look at their area because if I go there first, I will have no money left for anything else. So I usually try and have $100 to $200 left because they sell these like gorgeous real military equipment miniatures, but it's the most like if Russia made like a minesweeper in 1942 for 6 months and then stopped making it, they will have a beautiful like diecast miniature of that. Like, so I always say, so those are my three rules for Frankensons. I don't know how we got on this, but those are my three rules.
Yeah. If you've never been to Frankensons when this pandemic is over, that's going to be on your list. You're like number three or four things to do after you've given all your friends a big hug.
Yeah. But back to a toy store near you. I don't think you ever said where we could find this show.
Thank you. Thank you for helping me do my job and say the stuff I should be saying. It's going to premiere day and date on Christmas morning on Amazon Prime and YouTube. And then over the next couple months, it'll start popping up lots of other places like Tubi and Roku and Pluto and you name it.
Okay, so we watch A Toy Store Near You, then Wonder Woman, then Soul. Okay. Yes.
I don't know. So yeah, definitely start with Toy Store Near You.
Yes, definitely.
Luckily, I've seen it already, so I can start watching Wonder Woman at 12:01 in the morning.
Yeah, we've seen this, and I gotta say, this is probably one of my favorite series from you. And you've got like a billion series, and I love the independent feel of it, but yet you still make it look expensive by using all these clips from TV shows and movies. Did that take up the majority of your budget?
It took up the majority of the budget and therefore the time. I mean, people, we get asked all the time, why does it take 6 months between seasons? And it's like, well, do you want crap? Because then we could speed it up if you want crap. But I mean, the legal process involved with doing shows like this, mm-hmm. like that alone is 6 to 8 weeks combined.
Wow.
And, you know, we have the infrastructure already built because of our other shows, but you still can't. There's certain things you literally just can't rush.
Yeah. Oh, exactly. And I love the fact that I can pause the show and say, hey, Sarah, do you see that Shogun Warrior? And I'll give her an explanation of how I had this when I was a kid and played with it. And so now vintage toys and retro toys are the in thing. Why do you think these hold such a sacred place in people's hearts?
My theory, and obviously this is just a theory, I'm not a psychiatrist, to put it mildly, the toy yes, there's an emotional attachment to the toy, but what I really think it's about is for most people, and I'm not talking about crazy collectors like me, I mean, normal people, like, I think it's about the toy. It reminds them of who they were when they had the toy. And what I mean by that is, even though we don't think about it, we all remember the feeling of not having to pay taxes, not having to pay a mortgage, not even knowing what STDs are. It's like, so there's an innocence when we're younger. And there's an implication that you lose your innocence as you get older, as you become like Dark Lord of the Sith or something. But it's not really about becoming a bad person. It's just about life's responsibilities and weight on your shoulder changes you. So I think when you see an old He-Man figure and it reminds you of playing on your parents' carpet when you were nine and you didn't have the weight of the world on your shoulders, I think that's the emotional connection to that figure.
Yeah. Yeah. And once again, these are think pieces, these shows. And they're conversational starters because, once again, every episode is about 20-ish minutes, but it'll take us an hour to get through it because I'll pause it and say, okay, Sarah, those are the Mego figures I had when I was a kid. There's Urko, there's Batman, there's a Klingon. And it's so much fun. And then she'll say, oh, wait a minute, hold on. Did they just hold up a My Little Pony?
Yeah,
and
right?
They'll tell one of her stories.
So we can learn more about each other. Yeah.
Now, what was your toy store when you were a kid? When you were growing up, what was the independent toy store?
You know, and it's funny, you know, I'm from New York. Like, I'm not from some town of 800 people in you know, Wyoming. They didn't exist. There was a toy store. There was a comic book store that was 99% comics, 1% toys. But don't forget, what's vintage now in 2020 was like 8 years old in, you know, 1989. So like there just really wasn't a vintage market. So even in college, there was a comic book store in college that was probably 80% comics, 20% toys. But to the best of my memory and my knowledge, a pure vintage toy store that was started and run only on toys, I'm not aware of that existing until about 15 years ago.
When I was a kid, there was a couple of these independent toy stores, namely a store named Mr. Big Toyland. And it was run by a gentleman who hated kids.
Oh,
because when you walked in, he's like, what are you doing here? Get out. Oh, I'm sorry. But yet this guy could get all of the Kenner Star Wars action figures before all the Toys R Us's and the Child Worlds. He got them, and I don't know how he did it. And he would lord it over us. Oh, you want this Death Squad Commander, do you? Well, guess what? Come back in 2 weeks. It's right there in your hand. So, yeah, he was like the rock star of toy store owners.
I guess Long Beach had it when New York didn't.
This was back right outside of Boston. I lived in Newton, Massachusetts.
Boston has always had Newbery Comics.
Newbery Comics, yeah.
Newbery was into toys and vintage toys very early.
Yeah, they were into more of the vintage, meaning like a couple of years ago. Because I went to school at Emerson College right down the street from Newbery Comics. And it's like, oh yeah, this is vintage. 3 years ago, but you know what? It says Star Wars on it. And in the mid 80s, if it said Star Wars, you bought it because you didn't know when the next Star Wars product would come down the pike.
Back then, we didn't have 100 Star Wars shows coming.
Oh, if only. Now, I know we got to wrap it up in just a few minutes, but I want to talk to you about Mad About You. This is one of my favorite shows of the 90s, and you're more known for your TV specials and your documentaries. And I want to ask you how you got involved in the Mad About You reboot.
So we worked very closely with Paul Reiser, and we had produced a show for him that's on Peacock now called There's Johnny, which is all about the behind the scenes of the Tonight Show when Johnny Carson was the host. And so basically, I mean, long story short, you know, it was, you know, every time you turned on the news, there was another reboot. So it was like, why aren't we doing Mad About You? we had a meeting with Helen. We had a meeting with Sony, and we all got to work.
Nice.
And it was just on Spectrum, but now it's on Amazon Prime.
Correct. That's right.
Oh, ooh, fantastic. Got to put that on our Christmas wish list, watch list.
Yes.
Now, let's ask you, before we wrap it up, what's next for Brian Volk-Weiss?
It's funny. Sometimes this question is easy to answer. Sometimes it's hard to answer based on how many things we're doing that have been announced or not announced. Unfortunately, this is one of those times where the only thing I can actually talk about is we have a show coming out next year, early in the year, that we're doing with Dwayne Johnson and his company for Disney Plus called Behind the Attraction. And that's a very deep dive into all the rides at the various parks. We're doing a very big show right now. I can't say for who, about the Star Trek 55 year anniversary. So that comes out in September of 21. So I can't say any more than that on that one. And then we have a bunch of shows going that I can't talk about yet, I hate to say.
Wow.
They fire you if you talk too soon. So I have to be careful.
So this is your production company that's all involved in this too?
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. It's stuff we're making for sure.
Amazing. Well, wow.
If you ever need someone to talk about Star Wars Vintage Collection, or the Star Wars Holiday Special, anything Star Wars, retro, vintage, you have our number.
You know where to go.
Yeah. So if people want to get a hold of you on social media to say hello or to catch all of your shows, what's the best place to go to? A website?
I always say Instagram or Facebook. It's my name. If you care at all about what we're doing, just follow me. And I usually talk about stuff as soon as I'm allowed to.
Nice. All right.
Very, very good. And this, once again, A Toy Store Near You, coming out on Christmas Day, season 2. Perfect, because it's great for those last minute gifts.
I'm very biased, but I tend to agree.
It's Christmas Day, but here you go. A New Year's gift. There you are.
Yep.
All right, Brian, thank you very much for your time. And we're big fans of yours. Can't wait to see what's next.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Stay safe. And thank you. Thanks for having me back.
Skywalking contributor Eric Onkenhout wrote a companion article to this discussion with Brian Volk-Weiss that goes into his career and where to find the upcoming season of A Toy Store Near You, and that can be found at skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
Now, Skywalkers, we want to thank you all for listening.
Yep.
And just attending our live streams and all of our virtual events we've had since the beginning of this pandemic this year. It's just made this year so special in just a different way, totally a different way. So we want to thank you for that. And now what we have done, we put out on social media, we wanted you guys to share some holiday greetings with us, and we also wanted you to share maybe a little of what you're doing to celebrate this holiday season. So let's listen in to our Skywalkers.
Merry Christmas, Skywalkers. You wanted to know what we're doing to prepare for the holidays? Well, besides decorating, baking cookies, and watching classic holiday movies,
we are really looking forward to a visit from our favorite podcast hosts, Sarah and Richard.
We cannot wait.
Oh, by the way, here's some riddles for you.
Santa was having problems walking, so he went to the doctor for help. What did the doctor give to Santa to help him walk?
Was it a candy cane? I have one for you.
All right.
What do you get when you cross a Star Wars podcast with Baby Yoda and a Wookiee?
Oh, I know. It's pretty obvious. It would be a green star-shaped cookie.
You're right. You must have snuck in the kitchen when I was baking.
Have a very Merry Christmas and a happy
New Year.
Hello, Skywalkers. This is Trisha Barr from Fangirls Going Rogue. I'm going to be watching Wonder Woman and Disney Pixar's Soul on Christmas Day. I hope you guys have a wonderful and blessed holiday, and see you in 2021. Yub, yub.
Hi, this is author Adam Bray, and I'm wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy Hutties New Year.
Oh,
shoot. Ho, 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 ho.
May the force be with you.
Hey, hey, Richard and Sarah and all of the Skywalkers. It's Kelly and Courtney from Neverland Clubhouse. And we just want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, and a Happy New Year. Exactly. And we also wanted to tell you a little bit of how we celebrate Christmas Day. We wake up kind of early, about 6 or 7 o'clock in the morning.
Our mom just can't wait to do presents.
And she usually has hot cocoa waiting for us. And we open our presents. And
stockings.
And stockings. And usually we're done about 9 a.m. where she makes a big breakfast. And then...
Yum.
So then we're usually done by 10 a.m. to watch Disney Parks Magical Christmas Parade. Or, you know... the special.
Yeah, we're so excited to watch it this year. And then we just kind of laze around in the morning and listen to Christmas music and hang out with the family.
And Mom usually cooks like Christmas dinner / lunch because we usually eat early. And in Christmases in the past, we've gone and watched a movie, one of the big movies that come out, whether it be like Star Wars or Into the Woods.
We've done Mary Poppins.
Mary Poppins Returns. And this year, we're going to continue that tradition, even though we can't go to the theater, and we'll probably be watching Soul, Pixar's Soul.
And maybe Wonder Woman.
Yeah. 1984. But yeah, that's what we'll be doing Christmas Day, and we hope you guys all have a wonderful, wonderful Christmas Day if you celebrate. If not, just happy holidays.
Yes. And we also want to say stay safe, everybody.
All right. See you later. Bye.
Bye.
Well, hello there, Richard and Sarah. This is Jedi Schwa from Techno Retro Dads, and I just wanted to wish all of the Skywalkers and you a very Merry Christmas and a wonderful holiday season. And, you know, this year I am spending Christmas with the family, thinking back to all the wonderful memories we've had, and that's really what it's all about to me. Christmas is all about those memories that you've had over the years, and you can make them no matter where you are, no matter who you're with, and no matter what you have to do to keep everybody safe. It can be a great experience, and hey, this is a Christmas we'll never forget. So hey, happy holidays, Merry Christmas to all you Skywalkers out there. I can't wait to see you guys soon.
Hey, hey, Sarah. Hey, Richard. Hey, Skywalkers. So, the Doring family is celebrating the Christmas season, the holiday season, with actually having Santa come over on the 24th to give out presents to my sons. That's a tradition that I grew up with in Germany, and when I moved here in 06, I took that tradition with me, and so every year we have Santa coming by, and so that's a nice little surprise for the kids always, and they're always looking forward to it, and they perform a song or ABCs or whatever else they can do at their age. And yeah, that's how we do it in the Doring household. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Hey, hey, Richard and Sarah, or should I say ho, ho, ho. This is your good friend Joey from the Disney Universe podcast, Tiki Cast, and Mando Show. But first and foremost, very proud original Skywalker. And I just want to wish you guys a very Merry Christmas. I know this time of year we'd be kind of breaking down our favorite moments from the year, and a lot of us would be talking about Star Wars Celebration and D23. But, you know, with all that's happened, none of that happened, so we got to look forward to that for 2022. One thing we did still have was our awesome Skywalking Through Neverland family and community. Awesome shows throughout the year, and great guests. And it was awesome, as long as I've been part of the community, to see it really grow. And a lot of new people kind of introduce themselves and kind of step up. And very cool. Can't wait to see it grow even more in the next couple years. So, I wish you guys, your families, all the Skywalkers across the country and world, a very Merry Christmas And until we can hang out again soon, Happy New Year.
Hey there, it's Christy.
And I'm Amanda.
And we're from Sabers and Spells.
Hey, Christy, what are you doing to celebrate the holiday season this year?
Well, I mean, you know me, I love to eat, so I'm going to be eating tons of panettone, and because we got that for Christmas, and then playing Dejeric that we got on our trip to Disney World.
Ooh, very nice.
Yeah, what about you?
I think we're going to be eating lots of cookies that we just made and having some of my famous sprout bake and doing a little bit of Zooming.
Nice. Like Zoom calls with family.
Yes. Zoom family calls.
A little Zooming. Well, we just want to say happy holidays to all of you, however you celebrate. And we are signing out. Mischief.
Managed.
Always.
Hi, Skywalking Through Neverland. This is Shamim Dana wishing you a happy holidays and a New Year's.
Hey, hey, everyone. This is John Zincanero. Just wanted to wish Richard, Sarah, and the whole Skywalking family a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays. One thing I will be doing this year, since I can't go out for New Year's, will be to watch the Death Star blow up at midnight, probably consume a few glasses of Spatchka along the way. I hope everyone has a safe holidays, and may the Force be with you.
That wraps up our holiday special episode of Skywalking Through Neverland. We want to thank Brian Volk-Weiss for coming back in the show and getting us all excited for the second season of A Toy Store Near You. And we want to thank all you Skywalkers for sharing your thoughts and sending in your holiday messages. And we also want to thank all of you for commenting on all the posts in our Facebook group, our Facebook page, listening to the shows, watching our YouTube videos, and watching the live stream today.
And just a reminder, Trivia Fridays will not be this Friday, because this Friday is Christmas, but we will have a fun trivia day on January 1st, and it'll be during the afternoon sometime, not our usual 6:30 p.m., so that hopefully more of you can join us.
So we'll be taking off next week for an episode
next
week.
Oh, yes.
But we will be back on January 1st for that pop culture trivia tournament extravaganza bonanza.
And we're also going to have a Disney Gallery Mandalorian discussion, and because that's going to come out on Christmas Day on Disney Plus. So, yes, we will be doing that
probably right after our pop culture trivia tournament. Okay. Details to follow.
Okay. And that would be January 1st. So that's the next time we're going to do a live stream. All right. Taking off next week. All right, Skywalkers. So sign up to receive our weekly newsletter. You can go to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and look for the tab, sign up for our newsletter. The link to sign up will also be in our show notes. We would also like to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations. Are you thinking of a trip to Disney parks? Well, you can fill out a get a quote form at smallworldvacations.com. Their vacation planning is free of charge, so check it out and tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
Hey, Skywalkers, do you love Skywalking Through Neverland and want more content? Well, apparently Megan Rickards does, because she just says, "Dang it, I need more time with you guys live. This is always fun."
Aww.
Don't worry, we'll be back, of course. Got so much planned for the new year, including new shows.
Indeed, mm-hmm. Yes.
But if you do want more Skywalking Through Neverland content, consider becoming a member of the Skywalking Force, our Patreon. Bonus content begins at only $5 a month, so head over there to skywalkingforce.com and have a look at all the options. And thank you to those who are already part of the Skywalking Force.
Big, big thanks. Now, we are also part of the Skywalking Network. Where you can also find other great shows. And some of them aired this week, like Talking Apes.
Which this week, we have an exclusive interview with Mr. Icon himself, the National Treasure, Paul Williams.
So search your podcatchers for Talking Apes and Paul Williams and find that interview.
We talk Planet of the Apes, we talk the Muppets, and of course, we talk the monkeys.
Of course. Also, a new episode of the Neverland Clubhouse just released today. And that they got to interview a performer, Drew Hayashida, who performed at Disneyland in the 90s and was in Mickey's Nutcracker, which also aired on the Disney Channel. So they talk all about this amazing stage show that I am in love with now. And also on our network, we have Classic Marvel Star Wars Comics, the Max FX Podcast, and Resilience Squadron.
All coming out next week.
You can also find us at JediNews.co.uk and Fanthatrax. And if you want to get in touch with us on social media, we are at Skywalking Pod for Twitter and Instagram and TikTok. You can also find us on Facebook and really comment and share and just have fun in our Facebook group. So search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join. You can also email us, share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
Now, don't forget to stick around for bloopers with Sarah and her eggnog, her spiked eggnog, and other fun bits that didn't make it into the show. So, happy holidays, Skywalkers!
Merry Christmas! Happy New Year!
Happy Hanukkah! Happy Life Day!
All right,
everyone, we gotta go. Sorry, time's crunchy today.
Bye! And always remember,
Neverland on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Augushowitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
This is what you can look for. Wait, bleh.
Off to a great start.
Here we go.
I love this store, Mr. Big Toyland.
Aw.
They were awful people, though.